The world market and the world economies, as we see them today, are huddling around between the US Wall Street and the Main Street. And economic pundits are creating their benchmarks around this situation. So the Main Street is very curious to know what is going to be the outcome. Is it going to be a V-shaped recovery, a W recovery, or an L-shaped recovery? Would you be able to give us some light on that?
The probability of a V seems to be more pronounced at this point in time. And there are several reasons for that. Firstly, the situation arising out of COVID is actually a shock and it's not a systemic failure. So when we compare COVID with, say, global financial crisis of 2008 or the Great Depression of 1927, those were very different situations. Those were not shocks. So when did we have shock? So we had shock during 9/11. We had shock in 1987 when there was the Black Monday. During those times, if you really look at it and analyze the data, there has been a very significant trend that comes up, which most of the Wall Street or most of the experts are actually missing it. And that trend can be related to Newton's first law, which in very simple paraphrase means that something which is in motion tends to continue to be in motion. So what happened? During the Black Monday of 1987, on the run up to it, we were in an exuberant bull market. And then things fell off the cliff all of a sudden. But then thereafter, things started coming back. And when they came back, they continued to their journey up the scale. They continued their upstream journey all along the way. And we moved on from there to new heights in the period of time that followed the crisis. Similarly, when we look at the 9/11, that was again a shock. Post 9/11, we've continued to went downwards despite so much of a relief was thrown into the system by Federal Reserve. It may not be like throwing the kitchen sink like this time, but they, at that point in time, they also came out with a huge backstop. Despite that, we went down. Why? Because when we were hit by 9/11, we were already nursing a down trade arising out of dot-com bubble bust. And hence, post 9/11, things continued to go downwards. Fast forward to COVID, we had a 10-year bull run. And the trajectory was all up and up. So once we are coming out of this, and this time also we had significant backstop, probably never in history this kind of backstop was ever given. And so quickly, that's the most important part. More than decision making, timely decision making. So we will therefore probably come out of this on a V rather than a W or an L. Now, there are other factors which makes us believe that this is more a V recovery, at least in the near term. And that is, on the run up to this COVID, if you see, consumer confidence was one of the highest we ever had. And this consumer confidence was on the back of almost an 8% saving rates in America. With this lockdown, if you see, this 8% has actually moved into early teens during March and April numbers that are available with us today, and is expected to get into late teens by the time this stay home orders and lockdown measures are relaxed. We are expecting them to be relaxed in 40 states soon. So this kind of savings rate is quite unheard of. So that gives a significant amount of margin of safety. On the other side, while consumer confidence was so much strong, producer confidence was very much low. The businesses were afraid of a fallout or a negative fallout from US-China trade spat. They were also worried that because of the protectionism policies that these major economies are taking, it will affect world trade. Supply chains will get disrupted. On top of that, there were on and off bouts of inverse yield curve. Historically, inverse yield curve has always made us believe that, you know, it's just a prelude to a big recession or a depression coming our way. So businesses were holding back. They were pulling back. As a result, we walked into this COVID crisis with a very low inventory. And that's again another very significant tailwind. Every time we go back to a depression or to a recession, and the reason for a recession getting prolonged into a depression is because huge inventory buildup, the overhang of inventory, which we don't have this time. In fact, once the restrictions are normalized, people will go back and start consuming. It will be then producers or the businesses will have to step up to meet the demand. And that's again another reason why we will not probably see inflation, at least in the near term, despite so much of a QE, so much of liquidity. Then there's a third factor that is playing in. If you look at the government policy, the American government policy, they are looking for payroll tax holiday. That literally brings back almost about a 7-8% on either side, in the hands of the employer and on the hands of the employee. And both of these are going to be stimulated for consumption. And this holiday is likely to be for the rest of the year, at least till American elections. Because markets are a lead indicator. Anybody who is trying to get himself elected will always try to make sure that markets are kept in a good humor. So from here till then, probably we will see all these backstops in place or more coming our way, and hence we will see probably a V rather than a W or an L. Now, what can convert this V into a W? As we relax, as we go back to normalize, there is a chance that there will be a flare-up. In the absence of any vaccine in the near term, this flare-ups has to be managed in a very different narrative than the way we have managed it so far. We can't go back to lockdowns. If we go back to lockdowns, if we start going back to stop and start of the economy, it will certainly be a W or probably get into an L, because it will get to a stage where we won't be able to reignite the economy to its full throughput. Hence, we have to try other strategies, and these strategies are like herd immunity. I think Sweden has shown us the way. Although they had more deaths than the Scandinavian countries, but whatever they achieved was without any lockdowns. If they can achieve that, I think it's that we can take from their book and try and apply in our backyards. America can try and do that. More importantly, we have another big advantage. Although coronavirus or COVID is extremely contagious, infectious, Corona somehow chooses to attack and become more fatal for people who are elderly, 55 plus, or who have serious medical conditions, especially with their lungs. If we can just isolate them and make our limited hospital care facilities available only to these people, while we effectively make the rest of the economy, which is the wider main street, work with certain amount of discipline, go back to work with certain amount of discipline, I think there are very high chances that we will get to herd immunity much sooner than we probably can hope to get a vaccine, if at all we get a vaccine. So that's the kind of thing that we see from here and how things would pan out hereafter.
So Devneel, what are your perspectives on vaccines?
So in terms of vaccines, while there is a lot of noise happening out there, but our take is a bit different. We would rather like to see the situation from a base case scenario rather than a best case scenario. The best case scenario probably is that a vaccine not before 12 to 18 months. But given that human or medical sciences track record against vaccines is not that good, I think we have very few vaccines for most of the viruses. The real success stories are like polio and smallpox. The virus will continue simply because the virus will continue to keep mutating itself. If it doesn't do, then it's all very good. The virus may even die along the way, like just like SARS. So our take is mostly very different there. The take is that instead of chasing the vaccine story, we rather have to look for more a herd immunity story. And to that extent, we really feel that what we can achieve in doing is we have to make a choice. And that choice is between life and livelihood. So if you really see today where we stand, we are actually hold up between the devil and the deep sea. By locking us down in our homes, we have saved lives, but we have caused or created irreparable damage to the livelihood, especially to the livelihood of the people who are at the bottom of the pyramid. There's like 20 million job losses in America. And who has really lost these jobs? People who are low wage earners. If you really look at it, this job loss probably impairs the American consumption just by 3%. But these people are very, very badly affected. And this is one of the very important layer of our economy. The whole pyramid stands on it. So you can't just let it go just because consumption is less, savings is less, and they are mostly consumer durables rather than consumer discretionary. And hence, we have to really find a way that we preserve, conserve, secure the livelihood of the people. And hence, we cannot go back to a lockdown anymore. I think the governments, the politicians in power, the governments, they have been, the bureaucrats, they have been given enough time by way of lockdown to prepare themselves, to create capacities in the system. And now it will be time for them to deliver. And they have to deliver in a way that they don't fall back on a lockdown anymore. The countries that who will manage to do it, the provinces that will be able, states who will be able to do it, they will really come out in flying colors, and those who won't be able to do it, they will sink to the bottom of the pit. A classic example you can see between New York State and California. Both of them almost went in the same time for the lockdown. But just because California had the advantage of being a little early in the curve, they did a far better job than that of New York. And that applies not just to America, all over the world, to all economies, everywhere. So that's the key take. I mean, we shouldn't wait for a magical wand coming from High Street or a Wall Street medical brand with a vaccine and everything gets cured. We have to do our part. Each one of us has to do our part. We have to continue the social distancing. The governments have to make sure that the capacity is made available to the people who need them most. And we don't snatch the livelihood from the people in the pretext of securing or saving their life.
So in your opinion, Debneel, do you think this COVID situation is going to create a loss of trust and significant reputational damage to China? And will it lose out to countries like India and the USA?
Whether China will lose out due to loss of trust and reputation because of this COVID, again, we have a very different thought there. I think it's not a case in point for China, but it is more for whether America can take this or the rest of the world can take this as a wake-up call. If I may bring in an analogy here, probably this is America's second Sputnik moment. What I mean by that? At the height of Cold War, USSR marched ahead of America in terms of its space journey. And that's where America saw its first Sputnik moment, took the wake-up call to its right, and pulled up the socks, came out from there in a few years to become the first to put a man in the moon in 1969. The difference today is that China is not USSR. China is today much bigger, much stronger, and a much capable economic power than USSR was at that point in time. And China also knows how to harness technology. USA may have shown way to a lot of innovative use of technology, but China has taken those innovative use of technology from the US, a leaf out of the US books, and taken them and given them the scale. Today, WeChat has a much more scale than WhatsApp. So in those terms, and China is not going to give up. China is not going to give anyone any elbow room. Everyone has to actually create it through their own hard work and labor. So be it USA, be it India, be it anyone else. So China's problem is not what world can do to it. In our opinion, China's problem is China itself. If China can find a better use of its time, effort, energy, resources that it spends on cover-ups, I think China will move much faster, become much stronger, and much better from where it is today. Rather, we focus on the rest of the world and see what the world can do under this order, particularly United States. United States, using robotics, artificial intelligence, energy and storage, GIN, cryptos, blockchains, can they bring capacity back to near shore or onshore? Can it again become a manufacturing and consuming house by itself? Can it gain back its lost glory? That's the call that United States has to answer, instead of chasing China and trying to reprimand China.
Thank you, Devneel, for your time and the wonderful insights on this situation that is playing out in front of us. And we hope to see you again in many more such interesting conversations as the situation dynamically changes around us as it emerges. With that note, I would like to say stay safe and see you soon.